So how many of you know machine learning? A lot of machine learning. Pretty good. What programming language you use for machine learning?
Python.
Python, okay. Pretty good. Okay. Then I don't have to tell what is machine learning, right? So I'll just those who are new to machine learning, I'll just do one. I'll just ask small questions, please. I have any slide. Okay. So it's just a small quiz. What do you think? What will be the value for this? 81? And then what about this? On what basis you told that, did I mention anywhere that it's a square? On what basis? It's machine learning. I like that, okay. So you learned, right? You learned, okay, you inferred. So for 2, it is 4. Basically, I have not mentioned anywhere that it's a square, right? So you learned. So you learned that, okay, for 2, it is 4, for 5, it's 25. Obviously, for 9, it will be 81, and then. So what type of problem is this? Those who are working on machine learning, at least have the understanding of machine learning. What type of problem? So if you have something which you are trying to predict, which has a value like continuous variable, what type of problem is this? Regression? Yeah, exactly. It's a regression problem, guys. You're trying to predict something which could be any value. So from, it could be any value. So it could be minus infinity to plus infinity. It could be any value. So you're trying to predict something which the label which will not have any fixed range. So it could be any value. So I'll just do one more. So how many of you like play cricket or watch? I think most of us. So I just want your answer in this. So just imagine, so just take your time. So I want the results, so what will be, what do you think, based on this, whether we won or we lost, or it could be anything, the last match, like draw. What do you think? One, okay, so how do you want, what basis? I little louder, guys. The auditorium is very big, but the audience are less. Played in India? Okay, so yes, of course. Sour, very good. So played in India, obviously, when you play in India, obviously, like we'll get a lot of support. Obviously, we are really good at when we are playing in India, right? So outside, we don't have that much. Like in outside also we have, but played in India, and what else? Virat Kohli, always, right? So when so when I was kid, so when I used to see cricket, when I started watching cricket, right? So when we used to play in first innings, so we used to win. Now, after Virat Kohli, after Dhoni and all, they're really good, right? Whenever if you see the statistics, so obviously when Virat Kohli has scored more than 100, obviously we have won most of the cases. So how about this? So it's mostly maybe the batting pitch and we are really good at batting. How about this? On what basis? Yeah, maybe Kohli has not scored, Rohit Sharma has also, just Bumrah is a baller, right? So it's maybe fast bowling pitch, England or Australia, maybe New Zealand kind of pitch, or South Africa. So, and the Kuldeep Yadav is spinner, so maybe it's a fast bowling pitch. Yeah, obviously we don't perform well, right? So what are the outputs here? The point I'm trying to make is what type of outputs you have here. So how many, like you were the above example, the output which you try to predict, so it will not have fixed range. Whereas you'll have the outputs here. You will have fixed output, either you win or lose or maybe to draw. So, but whereas, you will not have the fixed output here. So it could be any value. So if I ask you square of 25, so you it could could be anywhere. So it could be 26, 25, or maybe if I ask you for 100, so it is some other value. So basically, you'll not have fixed range. So you are here, you have fixed output, whether you win or lose. So what type of problem is this if you're working on machine learning? It's a classification. Very good, guys. So you already have the understanding of machine learning. I'll just give few examples. So how many of you work, how many of you know Kaggle or working in Kaggle? So what type of problem is this based on what? Oh, sorry, it's still loading. So machine learning is not rocket science. Anybody can learn machine learning. If you have a Python understanding, you can easily learn machine learning. There are tons of resources which are there on the internet, so you can easily learn. And you can also solve problems. There are a lot of projects, like there are platforms like Kaggle, there are platforms like Analytics Vidya, Hackathons. There are multiple places you can get to learn, and also whatever the knowledge you have, you can transfer into the projects. So what type of problem is this? So we had, there are multiple problems at a high level. There are supervised and there are unsupervised. But I'm just talking about supervised so that you know, so it will be very easy. In supervised, we saw the example that whether India will win or lose, so where you have fixed output. So that's called classification problem. And then we had another example where you are trying to predict something which you will have an infinite number. So you will not have fixed range. So that's called regression. So based on that, so what do you think, what type of problem is this? So can you predict whether the person will repay the loan or not? Whether he'll pay the loan or not. So it's a classification problem. So guys, this is done. This project is no more. I mean, Kaggle is a place actually where you'll be, like, you know, the company, they'll host the problems, they share the data, and then they'll ask you to solve. Whoever wins, I mean, they'll get $70,000. There are a lot of conditions applied thing, but still, you know, it's a good platform to learn. So this is a live project which is going on now from Google. So what do you think? Customer revenue prediction. So let's say I go to any Walmart. So Walmart wants to know me how much revenue I'll give to them. So it could be anything, right? So I can buy something for 100 rupees, I can buy for 1,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees. So it is not fixed. It's a regression problem. So when you don't have the output fixed outcome, so it's alive, it's going on. If you want to contribute, you can contribute. There are kernels here, you can get to see the other people who have written the code, you can see. You have the data here, so it's basically a project. If you have the understanding of Python, you can start contributing to this. You can learn from someone else, kernel or code, and also apply on top of that. So it's a regression problem where how much each customer will spend money. So you can spend 10 rupees, you can spend 100 rupees, you can spend 1,000 rupees, anything like that, right? So this is how machine learning, these are the examples of machine learning. At a high level, you solve either classification or regression problem. Today I'm just going to talk about something like that. So when you are working on machine learning, what if you have huge data? So all these tools will not work. Whatever you see here, there are kernels. The tools which Kaggle hosts, they don't work here in the real time when you have a huge amount of data. So hardly you will have, you know, so 1 or 2 GB of data, which is fine to get started. But when you work on, working in a big company, when you are working on real big data, these tools, whatever you have understanding of those tools, those will not work. Today, I'm here to just tell you guys, okay, what are the open source tools and how do you contribute? When you want to work in a big company, so they work on massive amount of data. They don't work on, it is really good to get started, to get visibility, to learn. But when you are actually working on projects, there are companies who use all these tools, but still, you know, when they have huge amount of data, how should you build a scalable machine learning, and how should you learn? So that's the talk is all about, guys. I'll just show the PPT. Okay. So today's talk is more on Spark. But why it is something like Pi? Pi because Spark is Python. So that's the reason it's Pi Spark. So how this life cycle of a data science project works? So what happens, we'll have data. Just now we saw the data, right? So we saw one problem statement, whether a particular person will repay the loan or not. That's one classification problem. And one more thing what we learned is, we also saw one problem, like how much a customer will give the revenue. That's a regression problem, right? So you will have the data. Some of you will have a data. So data will be there in database. Data could be there in S3, Amazon S3, or Google Cloud, anywhere. So you'll have the data, actually. And you'll also have a business understanding, which is nothing but problem statement. And understanding of data, data preparation, modeling, evaluation, and deployment. This is what the life cycle of a data science project goes. So most of the time, you spend a lot of time in understanding data and preparation of the data. So most of the time, like if your project is for 1 year, the most of the time you spend in understanding the data and data preparation. So that's the core part of a data scientist. If you have really good understanding of your data, if you are preparing your data properly, then your algorithm is you know, so you, it's really going to be a best algorithm. So you have modeling, and then evaluation part is very less, and the deployment part is also very less. But most of the time you spend in understanding data and then preparing the data. So this is the core part of a data science. What in our day-to-day life, that is what we spend a lot of time in understanding data and preparing data. So what are the tools are there currently, which if you are doing Kaggle, so mostly you use something like import pandas as PD. So to view the data, to understand the data. So pandas is a tool to understand the data. So when you have data sitting at disk, so what you want is you basically bring the data into RAM to understand. Data will be there in disk, so which is nothing but database or could be any cloud. You bring the data to RAM, right? So you bring from disk to, you bring the data to RAM. So there are tools. So pandas is a tool, so which is there in Python, so you can easily use. There are multiple tools, but most of the time, if you are using Python, so pandas is a tool which you use. Okay, and then along with the data preparation, you also visualize the data, so understand the plots. So multiple plots you have. So Matplotlib is a tool again, so which you can use to visualize your data, understand the data, you know, so understand x and y axis, so understand multiple features which are there, which are really contributing. And then modeling part, we have something like Sklearn, which is scikit-learn, some people call this. They're all there in which package. If at all I want all these packages of Python, if I want, what tool I need to install in my laptop? Anyone? Anaconda, you've heard of Anaconda? Python is a snake, right? Anaconda is, what is Anaconda? Big snake, right? So like Anaconda has a lot of all these packages. So you just have to install Anaconda, you'll get all these packages. And then, so once everything is done, so you deploy a model into production. So we have Flask, we also have Django. There are a lot of web frameworks. By using those, you can deploy into production. This is what every day, so most of the data scientists, they do. So then if you have small data, this is all fine, right? So any questions still here? Please ask if you have any questions. Okay, what's the problem then? Okay, it's all fine, right? So everything is fine. What's the problem? So data is growing fast. So data is really, really, really going fast because of IoT, because of social media, you know, because of smart, a lot of things, right? Data is really going faster. Earlier days, you know, my boss has 17 years of experience. He started his career with analytics itself. So he used to work on analytics. He used to use Excel, right? So the data was very, very less earlier. Now, because of all this IoT, analytics, data science is not new, actually. It is there since long. So people used to use Excel. People used to use SAS. Again, SAS is really commercial, so it's very costly. So people started using R. So Python is also there at the same time. Python is people used to use for, you know, so building web application, enterprise application. Now Python is, you know, so after 20, 25 years, people are using, realizing the power of Python, that in the area of data science. It's not new, actually. The problem was, actually, we used to have all these tools, but the data was very, very less. And all these tools are enough, actually. They were enough, actually, to work on, you know, so that amount of data. But now we have a lot of data, actually. So every day we generate data. So every, like, a lot of people upload, you know, photos or YouTube videos in YouTube or Facebook. What happens, we are generating a data. So everybody is connected on the internet, so everybody is generating data. So to understand that amount of data, so these tools will not work. That's the reason. So yes, so data sources, we all know. You all know, what do you think, what are the big data sources? Social media, so there are multiple actually. So images, the cloud, web, IoT data. So this is a big data generating data sources. These are the sources actually, so which they generate data. Earlier also we did not have Facebook kind of a social media kind of thing, but we had data. So we used to have web applications. They used to generate log data or maybe transactional data. So for example, let's say bank. I used to have the bank, right? So they maintain all your history. So it's a transactional data. So it's not massive amount of data. It's just you can have one simple server to take care of all these things. Now, because of all social media, because of all images, video processing, right? All the data, the size of the data is growing like anything. All these tools, whatever the tools you have, they don't work actually. So that's the reason again, then what's the problem? So the problem, all these tools, whatever you have, they all work on a single server actually. Everything, whatever you take care, right? So they work on a single server. Everything will be maintained by only single server. Data storage, data processing, failures, everything will be maintained by only one person. So you're working individually rather than working as a team, right? So you're working individually to take care of everything. So obviously, it takes time. So you can't, you can't process massive amount of data working individually. So what's the solution? Solution is a teamwork. So imagine, instead of having one person, if you want to, for racing car, if you want to fix all the tires, so obviously you need a team, right? So when you're working on a team, you sometimes I've seen actually, I have a team, they work really good when they work individually, but when they work in a team, they do like this. So they work really good, but when they're working on a team, so obviously they don't, they work really good when they're individual, but when you're working in a team, they don't perform well. So for that, what you need a manager actually. So it's like a master-slave architecture. So you have a master and you have slaves working continuously to complete your task. So you need a manager. So this is a team hierarchy. I'll just give one example. I'll ask a few questions here. These are any software team, any software development team, it works. When you have project, so end of the day, you have developers who are actually working on something. So let's say this team leader who will be taking care of all these developers, so do you think all developers will be working at the same pace? All will be super awesome? No? So what happens? Let's say out of three developers, the team leader has to take care of everything, right? So whether it's one team, not like individual, but individually they will not be all at the same pace. So developer one is, let's say he's not well or he's not doing well or whatever it is, he's not coming to office. But team leader has to deliver stuff. Right? What are the challenges we see? What are the challenges as a team leader we face? So developer one, maybe let's say he's not well, he's not coming, whatever, what it could be any reason. So end of the day, team leader has to deliver stuff to team project manager. He has to give the status to project manager. So what happens? He will assign the same task to, so maybe who is fast, right? So he will assign the same task or he will do the task by himself. He basically assign the task to developer 3 or developer 4. So what are the challenges? Team, one player will be good, one player will be, developer will be really good, one developer may not be good. So basically, somehow team leader has to take care of everything. What are the challenges? So developer 1, developer 3, they might fight with each other and he has to take care of everything. So it is all manual, right? So it's all manual. So when you are working in a team, so what I am trying to explain here is, so instead of having one server, so you need to have multiple servers working together. So if you have a team, when you have multiple servers working together, so you need somebody to monitor, right? So one server will be with high configuration, one server with the low configuration. You need a team. So you basically need to monitor those things. That is where the frameworks are developed. So what the idea is, frameworks are like, so they connect all the servers together. You install some framework on all the servers. Then they make sure that they work together to complete your task. So as a team, so you work on one project or multiple projects, but So the tasks will be different, right? Each developer one will have different tasks, developer two will have different tasks. So basic idea is to have multiple developers working together to complete one project. That's the idea actually. So that's the framework. So Spark is one of the framework which is developed at University of Berkeley. So what the job of the Spark is to take care of, divide the task among servers, and then, you know, so aggregate the results and give it back to manager kind of thing. That's the Spark. So this is what, so when you are working as individual, you will have single core, maybe let's say 4-core processor, you have everything in one laptop. So when you are working in a distributed environment, like a Spark or a Hadoop, those frameworks, what they do is you have multiple small servers and you have one master who'll divide the task among all these small servers and then take care, you know, aggregate the result and show it back to the client. So that is what happens at a high level. So any questions here? No questions? All right. So yeah, this is how the master slave architecture looks like. So you have masters, you have multiple servers together working. So what you do is you install Spark or Hadoop. Instead of working one person, guys, so you take, you know, effort of a team and then complete your task. Simple as that. So you have master and then you have multiple slaves. They'll have RAM and they have a disk. So they process your data parallelly and then they give the result back to masters. That's all about I'm here to talk about. So Spark is one of the biggest framework in the industry, which can be used to develop this kind of architecture. So where you can have hundreds of servers working together to complete your task. So I have worked on nearly 300 terabytes of data, so sitting on 80-node AWS cluster. So which is, you know, if you have 300 terabytes of data, so if you have one server, even if you have very big one server, so you cannot complete your task, like, you know, so working as a team versus working as an individual. So that's the power of big data frameworks like Apache Spark or Hadoop. So what is Spark is basically it's a framework to connect multiple servers, to take the power of multiple servers and then finish your task. So that's what it is. So the tools which use pandas or NumPy or scikit-learn, they all work in one machine. So if you use Spark, you can take the power of a distributed system. You can take the power of a big data world actually. So that's what the Spark is. So the idea is it's an open source project. It is developed at University of Berkeley. And then PhD student developed that, and then it's the very biggest framework in the current industry. So now, so it can do ETL. So can anyone tell me what is ETL? ETL? Heard of ETL? ETL? Extract, transfer, and load. So you have data in multiple formats, you extract, and then you transfer into whatever the format you want, and then you load back. That's what ETL is. And then you have machine learning, graph processing. The beauty of this is you can code in Python, you can code in Scala, Java, R. It is developed using Scala, Scala programming language, but you can code, you can code in, they have the API in Python, they have API in R. You can use those programming language to complete. So yeah, so this is what it is. So you can read data from multiple sources. So, and then they have multiple packages in all this using programming language. So this is how real-time cluster looks like. You'll have data sitting at some disk, which is Hadoop distributed file system. So you use multiple workers, which are nothing but slave nodes, and you have one master. So we'll be working to complete your task. So after, when you have lifecycle of a big data science project, it's the same. So instead of pandas, you use something like Spark data frame. So again, for visualization, you can use Matplotlib, Plotly. There are multiple visualization tools. And then for modeling, again, you use Spark ML, and then evaluation also you can use Spark ML, and then deployment you can use Flask or Django. So this is the same architecture, just that the tool names are, the beauty is one more thing that you don't, even if you have hundreds of servers, it looks like one for you. So that's the framework. So you write code only one time. You don't write, so you don't divide the code among all the servers. You write code only one time, and then you automatically, framework will take care of dividing the task among the servers. So yes. So some code I have, I'll show it to you guys. So if you are really interested, so I'll show you the code. It's a so it's just a basic Titanic world program. So you have so you just have to import all the libraries similar to that. So you I have data sitting at Amazon S3. Yes, I'll just read. So the way, how do you read the data using pandas? So pd.read_csv to read the data. So you use similar way, spa.read.csv and then give the path and then rest all the code I've written. Actually, you can also see in my Kaggle account. So it's all there. Actually, you can view the data. You write the code only one time. You write the code like the dividing the tag, like if this data, so data will be stored in multiple servers, but you feel like, you know, so you're writing code in one server. That's the beauty of Spark. So you write like you give the path, even if the data is terabytes of data, so it will divide among the servers and take care of, you know, dividing the task and then do parallel processing. So Databricks is a place you can learn. You can also contribute to Spark. So Databricks is a startup actually. So they are the people actually who develop Spark. So they provide you 6 GB server. You can directly contribute, you know, so learn, and then you can easily start. You can utilize their servers to, they give a pre-installed AWS EC2 server, and then you can directly code using Databricks. So this is the notebook which I have in Databricks Cloud. So any questions here, guys? No questions? Is it too complex to understand? Too simple?
If the data is being divided amongst the different servers, and when we run our models on them, the algorithm will run different models for the different data sets. So is it possible like they can clash with each other in the same,
same model? Good question. So when you have data, actually data will be divided. So when you have big file, let's say 1,000 rows you have, what happens, what Spark says, you divide those, physically you divide those files. When you have 1,000 rows, what Spark says, you divide, okay, you keep first 200 rows in one server, remaining 200 in one server, like that, you actually divide the data. And then on top of that, once you divide the data at a storage level, on top of that, you apply Spark worker machine to process only 200 lines. So the question is, like how do you take care of all these things, right? It will not be, you know, so do you know something like how the random forest works? So it's an ensemble model. So you have multiple models training on your same data, or with replacement or without replacement, it's the same way. So what happens is their model will be applied on only 200 rows. If you have 1,000 rows, what happens is the actual data will be divided, physically data will be divided. One model will be applied on 200 rows, the rest model, all, let's say you divide your data into five blocks, each block having 200 rows, out of 1,000 rows you divide. So you'll have five models. And then finally, at the master level, you aggregate all those five models and you make one model. So basically, so the data will not be correlated, so you'll have individual models working on worker machines. Did I answer your question? So it's a good question. So yeah, so that's how Spark works. Yes, you can learn from Databricks. I'll share the slides. You'll also log in. Yeah, so official document of Databricks is really nice, and also official document of Spark is also nice. You can also learn from my code. I also have the code. Yeah. So if you are really interested, we have a team in Hyderabad. We also have a team in Bangalore, very big team. You can join as a fresher or internship if you're looking. You can drop an email. So if you know Python, that's enough. You can join my team. So we have a very big team of nearly 50 people sitting in Bangalore and then a few folks in DLF Hyderabad. If you're really interested, if you know Python, that's enough for me. So you can directly join team, so as an intern or as a full-time employee. So you can, if you are really interested to contribute, there are a lot of large big data sets which are also available in Kaggle. You can look at this data set and then code. Any questions? Further questions? So I just want to tell, okay, instead of working as an individual, you can use frameworks like a Spark to work as a team. That's it. That's what Spark is all about. But you write the code only one time. You don't write like code, you don't divide the code among servers. Frameworks like Spark will take care of everything. It looks similar like Pandas. All the algorithms are there. It's very mature. So it has been adopted by all top companies. It's really good. Any other questions? All right then. Thank you guys. Thank you very much.